So hopefully everyone can see my slides in the full screen mode. Could you let me know if it's okay, if it's moving? Is it okay for you? Yes, so thank you, Mark.
Yes, okay.
Yeah, very good. So my talk will be the introduction to the group work, the work of our team. So with most important contributions by Phil, Matt, and Dan, and other students as well, at the Materials Innovation Factory in Liverpool. So Phil was talking yesterday, and I'll mention some of his results in my slides. Matt and Dan will talk after me. So a year ago, when we had our first Maximin conference, our talks were called, my talk was called Introduction to Periodic Geometry. And you have seen already from several other speakers that we have now updates, not only from our group, but from other people, from Graham Day, for example. So we have progressed as well. And that's why it's it will be still an introductory talk, but at the end, we will come to the crystallized geometry principle, which is a new concept, rather recent. So let me first explain the key concepts. So we consider all solid crystalline materials, which we will briefly call periodic crystals or simply crystals. So they can have many types. And I guess almost all of you know that they consist of elementary blocks, motifs of atoms, ions, or molecules in a unit cell, periodically repeated on three directions. And these unit cells are not necessarily cubes, as for the ice crystal on the left. They can be rather different. And also we cover all inorganic crystals as well, but at the moment not yet quasi-periodic. So we focus on periodic crystals for a moment. So Bernd has nicely introduced many equivalence relations in his previous talk. And the first question I ask here, indeed, shall we consider, for example, these four lattices? So by lattices, I mean collections, infinite collections of black dots. Are these four collections of infinite black dots different or equivalent? Of course, it depends on the concept of equivalence. And our concept will be a bit different from the equivalence relations presented by Bernd. And in the interest of time, since many of you have seen these examples already, I simply explain briefly that we could easily shift. So we could take this unit square lattice in a very simple form by using the orthogonal basis, or we could choose a different primitive unit cell, and there are infinitely many choices of a primitive unit cell, but also we could shift our motif. So our point is, may not necessarily be at the corner, it could be in the center. And then we could also rotate our initial basis and get a rotated lattice. And again, if you change a unit cell, then the picture might look differently. So at least on the crystallographic information file, we'll see different numbers. But essentially, we have exactly the same square lattice. So if you forget about green lines, then you will recognize unit squares only rotated. So the third and fourth pictures are actually identical if you look only at the black points. Right, so this leads to the following ambiguity. If we represent as traditionally a crystal by a cell and a motif, then there are infinitely many representations. And yes, we know about reduced cells and Nieglis cells, so we'll come to that. But for a moment, imagine even if we fix a square cell, so fix a lattice, a unit cell, but choose a different motif, then we could easily end up with exactly the same periodic point set, exactly the same, well, in this particular case, up to translations. So, and that's why we would like to discuss this concept of equivalence in, say, a more axiomatic way, if you wish. So there are many equivalences of crystals. And Bernd introduced, indeed, different types of equivalence relations. So let me briefly remind, actually, the most general definition. what equivalence is called an equivalence relation. So there are three axioms written here, and most importantly for classification is the transitivity axiom. If A is equivalent to B and B is equivalent to C, then A is expected to be equivalent to C as well. And this axiom is especially needed if you would like to split our family of objects into well-defined separate classes, so disjoint classes. And indeed, in crystallography, the most famous classification is by crystallography groups, 230 classes. Yes, so there are many more classes, so geometric, arithmetic classes, many more. And if I remember correctly, Bernd, from your talk, we have always a finite number as a result. Yes, this number could be big. However, crystals are discovered even at a faster rate. So already the Cambridge structural database has more than 1 million crystals. That's why we would like to a finer or stronger classification, stronger equivalence relation to separate them. So that's one question about equivalence. And also many times we could hear the word similar crystals. So is such, when such a similarity can be called an equivalence relation? For example, chemists often consider crystals similar or very similar if they have close energy values. For example, within 1 kilojoule per mole or even smaller. So it doesn't matter what threshold we choose. They sometimes call them similar. So what happens in such a case when we fix a specific threshold? Or more generally, there are similar approaches when we try to split inorganic structures into so-called isotope configurational types and so on. And however, many, all of these past equivalences were based on parameters, so-called thresholds, to show that some crystals are similar or not, depending on a threshold. So one quick problem is that we have a dependence on a threshold. So our concept of similarity changes if we change a threshold depending on our systems, molecular composition, for example. But also there is a more serious problem with the transitivity axiom here. So if you assume that we can perturb, for example, a lattice, so this picture illustrates what happens when we continuously deform lattices. So if you assume that two objects, for example, lattices, can be perturbed if we change some parameters, for example, edge lengths or angles up to a small value, well, measure it in angstroms or degrees. So if we accept this definition of similarity, then what can we see? We see that any lattice can be continuously, slowly, gradually transformed by very small perturbations to any other lattice. So we could easily get a long chain of these small perturbations, which by the transitivity axiom imply that any initial lattices, for example, are equivalent if we accept this concept of similarity. So this is okay if you would like to focus on a say specific lattice or a specific crystal and look only at a very small neighborhood around. However, we can show that we can do better. We can compare any crystals, not only very similar, but any distant crystals as well. And you will see benefits of this, say, more distant approach. So now we introduce the equivalence relation, what we think is very important. So you might have seen crystals in real life in the form of solid rocks. So solid rocks are rigid bodies. And indeed, any crystal structure is determined in a rigid form. So when we go and get a diffraction pattern, we get it from a solid crystal. That's why it's very natural to study crystal structures up to rigid motion, which is a composition of translations and rotations in three-dimensional space, or up to a bit more general isometries, which also include mirror reflections. And this equivalence relation is the strongest of all possible relations we have discussed so far. for example, in the tutorial by Bernd. So under this equivalence relation, we get certainly infinitely many classes. So if you make a small perturbation, we get a slightly different isometry class. So we would like to study this space, this infinite space of crystals up to isometry and find suitable metrics on that space. So we'd like to define a crystal not as a single crystallographic information file, not as a single periodic point set, but the class of many, infinitely many periodic point sets that should be equivalent to each other up to isometry or rigid motion, for example, in the three-dimensional space. Right, since this is expected to be a tutorial, I actually encourage to ask questions right in the middle of the talk. You could use the chat if it's more convenient for you, but if you have a question during the talk, feel free to ask. So far, this slide introduces the key concept, the equivalence relation, which maybe didn't get enough attention in the past, because it's not easy to classify crystals up to isometry. Okay, if there are no questions, let me continue. So if you accept our aim to classify crystals up to isometry, then how can we do it? So in mathematics, we classify up to any equivalence relation by using invariants, so which are properties of functions that are preserved under this equivalence relation. So by definition, any invariant should take the same value on all equivalent objects, in our case, all isometric crystals. For example, starting from a hexagonal lattice on the left, we could take many different primitive cells or even non-primitive, but an invariant should map all these different representations into a single value of our invariant. And similarly, for a square lattice, we should have one value of an invariant. So unfortunately, not all, but some crystal descriptors are not invariants, so they're not preserved even under rotations and translations. But we argue that this is the lowest level. So certainly all invariants should be preserved by isometry because we have simply rigid motion and add reflections only for convenience. So we can certainly distinguish crystals up to reflection as well. That's why when big data here will not help, unfortunately. If you have many non-invariant data, it will be even more embarrassing. So we should really use invariants, even if not strong invariants. But you will see what strong invariants are also possible. So one of typical ways in the past to produce some crystal descriptors is to take a finite subset. We forget about lattice translations, so people even take simply a finite point cloud selecting a box or a ball of a certain size, say neighbors up to a certain cutoff radius. So even for the simple hexagonal lattice, this example show that it's very hard to justify that the resulting finite subset is an invariant in up to isometry of the original periodic point set. So if you fix the size, then we could easily get simply finite sets of different numbers of points. But even if you have the same number of points, without remembering about lattice basis, there is no way to reconstruct from a finite set our infinite set. So we still need to keep that basis to allow a reconstruction. What happens if you keep a basis? So it's great that one picture from Bernd's talk is very similar to the example here. So Bernd, you have demonstrated that when we take a square lattice and slightly perturb points, then we could easily lose our symmetry. Yes, great example. So of course, crystallographers knew about this ambiguity of a primitive cell and they tried to find a canonical cell, and indeed Nigli found more than 90 years ago, so-called reduced cell, now called Nigli cell. Yeah, this is great, so it's unique. However, it is discontinuous under perturbations, under almost any small perturbations in the following sense. So The first picture here shows the standard square lattice, and then if you perturb any every other point a little bit, even a little bit, then our primitive cell, our reduced cell, simply doubles in size. And if we add a bit extra perturbation, it could quadruple. So the symmetry goes from square to rectagonal. But sizes also change discontinuously. Even the volume of a primitive cell here changes discontinuously. So that's why we're asking the question, how we can continuously quantify a similarity in this case. So what invariants could see a small difference between the initial square lattice and the slightly perturbed square lattice? So before answering this question, let me motivate it. Why is it really important? Why is continuity important? So, well, physicists know the answer because atoms simply vibrate above the absolute zero temperature. At any finite temperature, atoms always vibrate. And when we measure diffraction patterns of the same material, at different temperatures or simply on another day, these measurements will come different, at least a little bit. So there will be some noise inevitably, but also, we now have too many crystals. So I mean, not only in the Cambridge structural database, where we have more than 1 million, we have many more crystals generated or simulated by crystal structure prediction. Crystal structure prediction tries to guess what molecules or chemical compositions can be converted into good crystals.
Hello.
What? A question?
Yeah, mine's gone cold. Thank you.
Okay. If there are no questions, then I'll continue. And these crystals were simulated on a computer. So initially, we could put molecules, say, in a random position in a random unit cell, and then iteratively optimize, and then start again. And what we get as a result, we have many local minima, but not even local minima, we get approximations to local minima. Because this energy function is very complicated, and after millions of restarts, it's very, very natural to expect that we could come to the same local minimum from different directions in this very complicated high-dimensional space. So we have many near duplicates. And even this particular data set of nearly 6,000 crystals, it was thoroughly filtered out, so initially starting from 1 million, but even this filtered data set contains dozens of near duplicates which were not detected by previous methods. But more importantly, you have too many predictions. So this term, embarrassment of over-prediction, was coined by Professor Sally Price, who is a world-leading expert in crystal structure prediction. So we predict here on a computer thousands, but synthesize, and that's a very good example of five polymorphs, but in comparison with 6,000. So what's the problem? The problem is that it's hard to actually distinguish these crystals. So this plot shows energy on the vertical axis, relative energy, and density, so simply grams over cubic centimeters, density, physical density of crystals. And here density is good because crystals are actually nanoporous, so density distinguishes them well enough. But for inorganic crystals, they are much denser, and density doesn't help at all to distinguish. So this density is actually a good invariant. So it is continuous. So previously you have seen many discontinuous invariants, but density is continuous. But unfortunately, it is too continuous. It is simply constant under perturbations. So it doesn't distinguish small perturbations at all. So we need more invariants to better distinguish crystals and completely map a crystal space. So this is an illustration coming from a talk by Matt later about lattices. So Cambridge structural database, all primitive orthorhombic lattices extracted from real crystals. And this picture simply illustrates that we have a continuum. So real crystals, even if you restrict them to primitive orthorhombic lattices, have have all possible values here. So you might see some white spots, which I simply explained that real crystals cannot have very small sizes because atoms cannot be very close. But everywhere else, there are no holes. So everything is possible. So that's lucky message, but that's why continuity is important. Okay, after all these motivations, we can, I hope, finally ready to state the problem. So we are looking for a complete and continuous isometry invariant, so a function from crystals, periodic point sets, or sieve files to numbers, to some numbers, vectors, or matrices, satisfying the following conditions. So invariance is the most basic. If two crystals are isometric, so equivalent up to rotation, translation, maybe reflection, then the invariance should take the same value. So that's why we should avoid any dependence on a unit cell, explicit dependence. Second condition, completeness. So this is much harder to satisfy because it says that this invariance should completely separate all non-equivalent crystals, non-isometric crystals. And there are infinitely many. If you take simply any two random crystals or a crystal and small perturbation, they will be non-isometric. And this invariant ideally should distinguish them. But this is not all continuity. So hopefully I have motivated continuity by several examples and problems, for example, in crystal structure prediction. And continuity means that the invariant should change only slightly under perturbations of atoms. So this is needed to continuously quantify a similarity between crystals. Well, so since we are working with real data, of course, this invariance should not be simply theoretical, they should be computable. And in our case, we are looking for fast algorithms, fast with respect to motif size, which is the main measure of complexity for crystals. And well, it's not hard to beat current approaches because even on a supercomputer, so the previous energy density plot was produced, so it was the result of a long simulation over 12 weeks. And the ultimate aim of this approach of periodic geometry, of this classification, is inverse design. So our complete invariant should not be only computable, but it should be simple enough to allow a full reconstruction. So that we take a new value of this invariant and go back to our original, to a new crystal. So from a new invariant, we could go back to a new crystal and potentially discover a new material. So we would like to have this invariant as simple and as explicit as possible, so that the inverse map is easy to implement. Okay, so let me now make a connection to the talk by Phil Smith, who yesterday introduced density functions, so non-electron density, so we call them density functions, and this word is closer to probability failure. So the formal definition is written here. So let me briefly explain. So we have a motif in a unit cell, and we grow disks or balls around our points uniformly, so at the same rate. So the radius is increasing, and we look how they overlap. So we count the volume of intersections of k balls. So the volume covered exactly by k balls with an increasing radius t with fractional volume within a unit cell is called the value of this density function at the radius t. And this was historically the first continuous invariant we have found. And already that invariant detected that something was wrong with CSD, Cambridge Structural Database. So we had some, this experimental T2 crystals, again, you have seen earlier in the previous slides. So our coffers were supposed to deposit alpha, beta, gamma, delta. Well, epsilon is not yet deposited, but delta was supposed to be in the CSD, but our invariants couldn't find it because what we were given as T delta was actually another form of beta. Yes, CSD contains two slightly different forms of beta, and when we looked at numbers comparing with distance functions, density functions in the simplest L infinity distance, L infinity norm, when we saw large numbers, large unexpected numbers, so these are simply non-extremes. And we asked why that's so for other differences between experimental and simulated crystals were much smaller. And indeed, at that moment, our colleagues realized that they somehow forgot to deposit T2 delta. So it wasn't in the CSD, but now this crystal is saved and has a different ref code in the CSD. So so this invariants are continuous, and we even proved completeness for so-called generic crystals, so in general position. And the computation was fast enough on a laptop, so only hours on this whole data set. But yes, we wanted something faster and more explicit. So let me illustrate the difference between square and hexagonal lattices. So here with density functions are combined all together. So you see the first density function initially for the square lattice growing quadratically, as expected. And then the second curve, we add psi 2. So this is the second density function. So this is the fractional volume covered by one or two disks in the unit square. And then so on. So we add more. So we have 8 density functions for the square lattice, 8 density functions for the hexagonal lattice. And yes, they look different. So of course, these lattices are not isometric. We have tried it on much harder examples, so-called homometric crystals. Homometric crystals, by definition, have identical diffraction patterns. However, density functions manage to distinguish them. We have taken the example from the classical patterns in this paper. We have 24 atoms in a unit cell. Yes, differences are a bit small, but still we can see, so they are larger than floating point errors. Okay, now let me go to another problem, which is even more complicated than isometric classification. So what could be a proper metric on isometric classes of crystals? So we are looking for a function depending on two crystals, S and Q, satisfying the following metric axioms. So these axioms are classic, and I would like to highlight the key difficulty here. The key difficulty is actually in the first axiom, because it is bidirectional. So the distance should be zero if and only if two crystals or any two objects are equivalent. So in our case, if you, for example, it's easy to get some similarity between crystals, say take density of one crystal, density of another, take the difference, absolute value. So this absolute value of differences of densities certainly satisfies the symmetry, triangle inequality, but not the first axiom, because we could easily have different crystals with exactly the same density. And similarly for any other non-complete invariant. To guarantee the first axiom, that difference can work only for complete invariants. That's why this problem is actually harder than the classification. If you know a metric, we can say whether two crystals are equivalent or not simply by checking the distance between them. If the distance is zero, they are isometric. If not, why not isometric? Any questions so far? Okay, so if not, I'll continue and discuss popular similarity measures. For example, root mean square deviation, widely used and implemented in Mercury by visualization software by the Cambridge Crystallographic Data Center. So if you have two crystals and upload them to Mercury, then it tries to match a certain number of molecules, actually up to 15 by default, but you could change this number in two crystals by finding a best rigid motion to somehow match up to 15 atoms or molecules in the first crystals and up to 15 in the second. And if such a match is found, then it outputs the root mean square deviation, computed here simply as the square root of the average sum of square differences. Okay, Len, what we know about RMSD is that it fails the triangle inequality, and is actually, so this is a bounded version of the bottleneck, bottleneck metric, bottleneck distance. So what does it mean? So it means, so the bottleneck distance is also a classical concept. Usually it is defined on finite sets, but it makes sense formally for infinite sets in the following way. So we are looking, we consider all possible bijections between infinite sets, and they take the supremum, so the upper limit for the perturbation of a point between a point and its image. So so roughly this bottleneck distance measures the maximum perturbation we need to match two crystals completely. However, so this distance can be easily simply plus infinity for infinite sets. Well, very simple, if you take integer numbers and then integer numbers multiplied by one plus any small epsilon, so have say zero, one plus epsilon, two plus two epsilon, three plus three epsilon, then probably it's easy for you to see, but for any small epsilon, if you look at say, first 1 million points around the origin, then the second set Q will have much smaller points in that range. So we need to shift our points along a long distance to match them completely. So this bottleneck distance simply becomes formally infinity. And our problems with the root mean square deviation, that it very much depends on our parameters. So there are also parameters, thresholds on allowed deviations and allowed angles between between certain bonds. So if you change the number of this maximum matched molecules, then root mean square deviation simply continues to grow. And for this particular challenging case, T2 delta crystal, the closest simulated match is not so close in terms of angstroms. So we actually suspect that the real experimental crystal was not really found by simulations. Okay, let's let's now mention the complete invariant isoset, which was published in this proceedings of discrete geometry and mathematical morphology. So this is a summary slide. I have more slides explain details, but in a summary, it is a continuous invariant. It is provably complete for all crystals, not only generic. The computational time is similar to density function, so it is a bit slow than we would prefer, but it is explicit enough to allow inverse design. so very briefly, this isoset invariant, it reduces the equivalence from isometry plus a change of basis to only rotations around a fixed center. Yes, we still have infinitely many rotations, so that's why it's not it may not be it's not completely trivial how to find say a difference between rotated crystals even if you have a fixed center. But we also designed a theoretical definition for a metric which satisfies all metric axioms, metric continuous under perturbations, and an algorithm that can approximate with theoretical distance, so minimized over infinitely many rotations, up to factor four in the three dimensional case. But the whole construction makes sense actually in any dimension. So this factor four seems to be enough to detect near duplicates when you have indeed very small differences. Then up to factor four, but small differences will be again small enough. Now let me try to understand if I have time to go through details, or I should possibly skip these details for another talk and go to So maybe I'll mention formally the statement of this theorem. So two periodic point sets with a so-called common stable radius. So let me briefly explain. So previously, people constructed crystal descriptors, for example, SOAP or symmetric functions, atom-centered symmetric functions up to a certain cutoff radius. Yeah, there are more descriptors based on the concept of a cutoff radius. So here we argue that this cutoff radius is not enough. So for any two crystals or for a finite data set, we should find a suitable, we call it stable radius to distinguish them. So that radius depends on given crystals. So we know how to find good upper bounds for that. So that's why it's not a fixed threshold. We can find an upper bound and then compare either sets at least stable radius. So two sets are isometric if and only if the either sets of these crystals are isometric and briefly via so-called weighted distributions of local isometry classes. Okay, and so there is an extended version of this particular paper that defines a distance I mentioned, so a metric which is continuous under perturbations, and briefly it is the classical Earth movers distance on weighted distributions or probability distributions. So our isoset is a family of classes with weights, and we can compare different distributions with different numbers of sets by using this EMD, Earth movers distance. So continuity is expressed in that simple form of bottleneck distance on the right hand side, which means that if we perturb our points, if up to say epsilon, so up to sufficiently small distance, then the corresponding distance between either sets is maximum to epsilon. So it's called Lipschitz continuity in mathematics. Okay, but now let me go to our most recent invariants. So this is joint paper with our director, MIF director Andy Cooper, who is not only a director, but I should say a proper scientist. So we have first simple invariance average minimum distances. So this is a summary of this invariance. We're fastest, but not much slower our latest point-wise distance distributions, which are also provably complete and general position. And Dan will talk so in details about this invariance in the periodic case. Let me briefly mention the finite case. So you have seen previously that going from a periodic point set to a finite subset is challenging. So it's hard to justify that we keep our isometry equivalence. But going from a periodic point set to a finite subset is easier because it's from a harder case to a simpler case. And indeed, even material scientists considered the finite case as well. And this is a very recent paper in Physical Review Letters highlighting how hard it is to distinguish atomic structure representations. So it's called incompleteness of atomic structure representations. It's reviewed many invariants and suggested several challenging examples. So pairs of sets that cannot be distinguished by interpoint distances. So what do you mean here by interpoint distances? So it's not a usual distance matrix when we have say indices and distance between points I and j. No, we'd like to avoid labeling points. That's why we do the following. So for any point, we count, we look at neighbors. So distance to the first neighbor, distance to the second neighbor, third neighbor, and so on. So we have for every point distances to neighbors in the whole infinite set. So not restricted to a unit cell. Well, sorry. So that's a finite case. So you have frankly many points. Right, so we have one list of distances for one point, another list for the second point, and so on. So we have several rows in that M times K matrix. So the ordered list of distances. To avoid dependence on ordering of points, we order not points, but rows lexicographically. It's easy to show the example. So that example of four point sets is very classical, very simple. you have 4 points, 6 distances, and these 6 distances are exactly the same for these 2 sets. But if you put them into our pointwise distance distribution, we could see that in the trapezium, for example, we have 2 pairs of similar points. So these 2 points are similar in the sense that the distances from them to neighbors are the same. So root 2 to root 10. That's why instead of 4 rows, it's more convenient to have a smaller matrix with collapsed rows. So if you have identical rows, we collapse them and assign a weight. So this weight says that we have half of our points have this list of distances. So for the trapezium, and then for the kite example, we have only 2 similar points with exactly the same distances to neighbors. That's why we have 3 rows, and now we can, well, we see very distinguished. But with PDD, so simplest distance distributions are not enough to distinguish more challenging cases. And this is the most complicated. So only 6 points in 3 dimensions, but depending on three parameters. So these distances, so L1, L2, L3, were almost arbitrary. So simply positive numbers. And as a result, we get 6 points on the left, 6 points on the right. The only difference here is in the orange points. So you see the projection to the two-dimensional plane XY, but these points O minus O plus, they differ by the last coordinate. So sets are very similar, and if you look long enough at the picture, it will be obvious for you that we cannot distinguish them by simply looking at distances from a point to a neighbor. Really challenging and infinitely many examples. But we have extended our PDD invariants to higher order when we look at neighbors not to a single point, but to subsets. So for example, for order 2, we consider all pairs and look at distances to that pair. So you have a pair of distances instead of a single distance. So this more advanced higher order pointwise distance distribution is an isometry invariant, continuous in suitable Earth movers distance. And most importantly, so it distinguishes all these examples. So we actually conjecture it is a complete invariant for large enough k. So of course we should have enough neighbors to count not only for the finite case, but also for the periodic case. And in the periodic case, we proved that so-called distance generic sets can be explicitly reconstructed from first order PDD if you use also lattice invariants, which will be discussed in Matt's talk. One more important novelty here is the time. So these invariants are really fast to compute because all these computations are based on k nearest neighbors. And this is a classical problem in computer science to find closest points. So there was a lot of research. And we're actually correcting some past mistakes. So there will be an update from our group, say within a month about these complexities. But very briefly, if, for example, H is 1, so first order, then it is a near linear time in the size of our set. So here M is the number of points, or in the periodic case, it's the number of motif points in a unit cell. Right. So one practical example from me. So this is the set of all crystalline drugs in the Cambridge structural database. So minimum spanning tree based on distances between our invariants. So minimum spanning tree means that we built a tree which minimizes the total length of edges by spanning all vertices. So here every vertex represents a single crystal in the CSD. And hopefully this example can be understandable for even for non-chemists. If you sometimes come to a pharmacy, you might find paracetamol and aspirin on the same shelf. And it was, well, surprising or not surprising, but we have found paracetamol and aspirin close to each other in our tree without using any chemistry at all. So molecules are little bit different, but our tree was built on pure geometry. So we have used only coordinates of atoms. And this leads us to the following question. So at the moment I ask it as a question only because we need a bit more time simply to, well, to show it on paper. But the idea is the following. If we map all crystals to periodic point sets, so every atom is a single point. So exactly the classical approach of mathematical crystallography, but also we study them up to isometry now. So if you forget about chemical elements, which can be actually easily added, but even if we forget about them, so this picture on the left is an illustration from the book of Nobel's laureate Richard Feynman. And already dozens of years, so Richard Feynman understood that some crystals can be similar, so they have the same crystal lattice, but they're still different. And Bernd actually in his talk demonstrated a very similar example. So diamond lattice structures for silicon and carbon. So yes, if you forget about Lacanian chemistry, lattices differ by the geometry, by the sizes. So if you forget about elements, we can still distinguish all these crystals simply by minimum distance between nearest atoms. So that's why we think that if you map all known crystals, so from the Cambridge Structural Database, for example, to periodic point sets, then we can still distinguish. So we cannot get exactly isometric periodic point sets, which means that all crystals as a result can be studied in one huge space. Yes, it is huge, but we can measure a difference, a distance between them, even without any extra restrictions. So without specifying a symmetry group or a chemical composition, we could do it well more widely. So that's the idea. And let me finish again with the future vision, what we can do on that common crystal space with our metrics. So at the moment, when we, for example, try crystal structure prediction, we get a local minima, and if we invert this energy function, so this is an illustration in terms of height, not local minima. So we see peaks, we see local peaks, but no locations of these peaks. So we are not sure whether two peaks are close or more distant. Everything else so is covered by a cloud. And we would like to remove this cloud and see much ahead. We would like to see distances and join, yes, closer points by distances. And when I realized that, for example, a phase transition, so transformation from one polymorph to another is a continuous path in this space where we should know a metric. So our vision is to completely parameterize this crystal space by proper metrics satisfying all metric axioms. Thank you. And now let me try to stop recording first.